Rumble. It's clear and easy to follow. It's about the Indians who rocked the world. This feature-length documentary premiered in 2017 at the Sundance Film Festival, where it won the World Cinema Documentary Special Jury Award for Masterful Storytelling. The film was produced by Resolution Pictures, which is an Aboriginal-owned production company based in Montreal, Canada. And it was directed by Catherine Bainbridge and Alfonso Morano, who also served as the film's director of photography, which enabled the filmmakers to focus on a strong visual narrative with enticing visuals. The production of Rumble starts with the recreation of an ethnomusicologist recording a musical session of a Chippewa singer in 1907, which sets the scene for the film. It juxtaposes the idea of Indians recording music because the government thought it wouldn't survive, and Indians recording music because they love it. In one brilliant camera shot of transitioning the Chippewa singer into Link Ray, who happens to be played very well by the Mohawk musician Derek Miller, we, as an audience, can start to understand how these early recordings from 1907 influenced modern music in North America. From this point on, the film is then broken into several segments that track Indigenous musicians' influence and contributions to the music industry in North America, from its early beginnings to its current musical landscape. The first musician to be addressed is Link Ray, a Cherokee and Shawnee guitar player influential to almost every aspect of the rock and roll guitar sound, from inventing the power chord to playing with heavy distortion. Link's music was so powerful that he had the only instrumental song in history to be banned for fears that it would incite teenage gang violence. The editing here helps to better tell the story by combining visuals from archival photos and videos, interviews, animations, and recreations, establishing a pace that carries throughout the film. A pace which seems to cut very nicely to the eponymous song, Rumble. Pira Faye talks of her women's a cappella group, Ulali, and the connections they have to the land in North Carolina, which is fortunately depicted in the beautiful cinematography this doc has to offer. It's on that land which several tribes called home prior to colonization, and it's on that land where they developed the style of music they were known for. From the similarities between the music of the Choctaw tribe and Charlie Patton's Delta Blues, to the music of the Coeur d'Alene people and Mildred Bailey's jazz, it's made clear that the indigenous people of North America most certainly had an impact on the musical direction that North America took since colonization. And this is all complemented by the music and sound design that utilizes the songs being talked about to provide context to the viewer as well as introduce a new audience to the music in question. Indigenous music was clearly an influence in blues and jazz, which in turn shaped the sound for generations of rock and rollers. But it wasn't always so clear that it had an influence on folk music. That is, until Buffy St. Marie. Several interview subjects, such as Indigenous actor Gary Farmer, attest to how Buffy was the first musical activist that they remember having a large following at the time. And through some great direction in the interviews, Buffy herself reveals how her music had been suppressed by the White House, the FBI, the CIA, and many major media outlets, continuing on the theme of cultural suppression. The imagery in this sequence is heavier than in others, as it deals with a lot of political activism surrounding racial discrimination in America. A theme that is carried on to the next electrical rock guitar sequence of Jimi Hendrix, Robbie Robertson, and Jesse Ed Davis. From the archival footage of Jimi Hendrix playing the Star Spangled Banner at Woodstock, to the photographs of John Lennon and Jesse Ed Davis together in studio, to Robbie Robertson playing in the band after touring with Bob Dylan, it's clear that the filmmakers have done their visual research to support the theme of Indigenous musicians' connection to political activism in America. The filmmakers are also not afraid to shy away from the tragedies of the music industry by showing the pitfalls in the career of Jesse Ed and his struggles with addiction, a moment that is emotionally underscored by the music and imagery accompanying the content narrative, and it is certainly inspiring despite the tough subject matter. A common thread through this film is the theme of Indigenous musicians constantly learning from the past generations and continually inspiring the future generations of musicians to carry on the fight against cultural suppression, a theme which is exemplified by John Trudell and Stevie Salas in the final segment that features Pat Vegas from Redbone, Taboo from the Black Eyed Peas, and the heavy metal drummer Randy Castillo. Through the use of archival concert footage and interviews, the filmmakers are able to show the direct musical connection that indigenous artists have had on each other by getting Pat Vegas and Taboo together for one interview to discuss their styles, as well as by showing the connection that Randy Castillo had as a drummer to the musical drumming style from his home tribe, and ending with a few words of encouragement from Randy to the next generation of musicians.
Stick with it, you know, and you'll do it if you want it bad enough.
Overall, Rumble is a great portrayal of the historic role that indigenous people have played in the shaping of the music scene in North America. Although, the film should not be met with only positive criticism, as it is not without its flaws. One of the biggest issues to address is whether or not the film should be considered as an indigenous one. Some things to consider is that both the directors, Catherine Bainbridge and Alfonso Morana, seem to have made no claims to indigenous ancestry. The production company Resolution Pictures is owned by one of Rumble's producers, Ernest Webb, who is a Cree filmmaker, and the Apache guitarist Stevie Salas served as one of the film's executive producers. Personally, I think the film is an indigenous one, but on one side of the spectrum. Sure, it's not as indigenous as some other films that feature entirely native casts and crews, but I feel as though it should be considered as an indigenous film. While the story was consistently clear throughout the film, I felt as though there were some unnecessary elements added in that could have been left out entirely, such as a few interviews that came across as a little patronizing to an indigenous person. It felt as though the filmmakers at times just wanted to constantly show a recognizable white celebrity talking highly of an indigenous musician. While this was most likely done to draw in a larger demographic to the film, for me, it diminished the impact of certain messages that the filmmakers were trying to communicate. Finally, the film very briefly touched on Canadian musicians and instead focused on the United States, and because of this, I feel as though the film could have just as easily been called Rumble, The Indians Who Rocked the USA. Despite these minor criticisms of the film, Rumble is certainly an entertaining and educational piece worthy of your time.